So we left off talking about tumor suppressor genes, and now we're moving on to the proto-oncogenes, which are a second class of genes that can be mutated to cause mutant proteins that can lead to unrestrained proliferation of cells and therefore cause tumors. So let's talk about some of those, for example. Excuse me. There can be growth factor receptor mutations, which cause more growth factor receptor proteins to be present on the cell surface than in normal cells. And that is true for many cases of breast cancer. So for example, let's consider the epidermal growth factor receptor, which becomes the gene for the epidermal growth factor receptor becomes amplified in 70% of all human breast cancers. That's very significant result. And by amplified here, we're not talking about the amplification of a kinase cascade. We're talking about amplification of the actual gene that encodes the EGF receptor. So normally in a normal diploid human cell, you would have two copies of the EGF receptor gene. And what happens in 70% of human breast cancers is that on one or more of the chromosomes, that EGF receptor gene becomes amplified into many copies. And those many copies then encode much more protein, EGF receptor, than would be found in a normal cell. So a normal cell will represent as having a very low density of EGF receptor on it. And therefore, there can be EGF, that is epidermal growth factor, around, in which the cell might not respond to fairly low concentrations of EGF because the chance of a EGF molecule finding a receptor is relatively small. But in a cell in which the EGF receptor gene has become amplified greatly, then there are many more EGF receptor proteins studding the surface. We have a studded surface of the cell with EGF receptors, and therefore even low concentrations of epidermal growth factor, the signal here, even low concentrations, has a very good chance of being detected by the numerous receptors on the cell surface. And this then can lead to the cell thinking that it should grow, it should divide, even when there's very low concentrations of the growth factor, which induces proliferation around. So these cells divide more easily and therefore can form tumors more easily than in other cases. So again, this is caused by gene amplification, which causes a hypersensitivity of the cell, if you will, to EGF signal, epidermal growth factor. It's like you see a police car or an emergency vehicle that is studded with antennae. It's very sensitive to any signals that are out there, whereas a normal car just has one antenna and it's not that sensitive. Excuse me. Here we have a hypersensitivity to the signal. So that is one case where we can have a proto-oncogene mutation. And I'm going to talk about the difference between proto-oncogenes and tumor suppressor genes in a moment. But right now, let's move on to the RAS protein, which is a monomeric G protein. This is a monomeric, not a heterotrimeric G protein, but a monomeric, a single protein, monomeric G protein. And as you know from our treatment of signal transduction pathways, this RAS protein is an intermediary often in the receptor tyrosine kinase signaling transduction pathway, which can then signal growth to the cell by turning on genes required for cell growth. And if the RAS protein is mutated in such a way that it is constitutively active, meaning it's always active, even when there's no signal around, there's no signal here, but the RAS protein becomes active because the gene encoding it, it has mutated, and therefore the RAS protein has a changed amino acid sequence that causes it to be inappropriately active, then the signal transduction pathway leading to growth is always on, even when there's no growth factor or growth signal around. So that is another class of genes, or another example, I should say, of genes that represent proto-oncogenes that can be mutated to cause cancer. And what I mean, what we mean here by proto-oncogenes is that these genes are serving normal functions in the cell. And when mutations occur in them in such a way, if we have a mutation in the DNA that encodes the proteins that are encoded by the proto-oncogenes, and the mutation results in the transformation of a proto-oncogene into an oncogene. This is a proto or pre-oncogene, and now we have an oncogene when mutation occurs in a certain way. Onco is the prefix which means cancerous. So it's a it becomes a cancer gene when it is mutated, when a proto-oncogene is mutated in a certain way. In the case of growth factor receptors, we gave an example of amplification of the genes. In the case of RAS protein, we have an example of mutations that are that inappropriately activate the protein by changing its amino acid sequence. And the RAS protein is activated in 20 to 30% of all cancers. Src kinase is another example. It's activated by mutations, and it's found in this activated, mutated form in 2 to 5% of all cancers. Now, let's go back. Now what you can see is that, what you can see is that the proto-oncogenes here would result in the following genetic behavior. If you have a mutant copy of a proto-oncogene, it doesn't matter if you have a normal copy of the gene around, because the gene is active inappropriately. And so this will lead to tumor formation. This can lead to tumor formation. And of course, if you have two normal copies, you're fine. There is no cancer. And if you have two mutant copies, that's bad news too. That leads to a tumor as well. So you see, the difference between proto-oncogenes and tumor suppressor genes is that for proto-oncogenes, you only need one mutant copy to lead to a release from the normal controls of cell proliferation that are operating on cells. And so proto-oncogenes, when mutated to oncogenes, are dominant. That is, oncogenes become dominant. They're dominant mutations. You only need one mutated copy in order to have the cancerous or tumor phenotype appear in cells. So let's look at an example of this and consider a signal transduction pathway that is a receptor tyrosine kinase pathway that goes through RAS and activates MEK, which is a protein that phosphorylates ERK. ERK is a kinase which phosphorylates target proteins, and those target proteins can phosphorylate retinoblastoma, for example, our friend retinoblastoma. And when that happens, when retinoblastoma is inactivated by phosphorylation, it releases E2F, which then causes cell proliferation by causing the transcription of genes that cause the cell to go into the S phase from the G1 phase. So look at you could have a tumor suppressor mutation of the retinoblastoma protein such that it was always inactive in its inactive state. If these are mutated, you have oncogenes being mutated in such a way that this signal transduction pathway is active even when there's no growth factor around or little growth factor around. And in the case of the epidermal growth factor receptor gene amplification in human breast cancers, you would have a cell in which there were many, many, many of these growth factor receptors around because of the gene amplification that has occurred. Here's the alpha helices here. Let's make it a little more realistic. So that any little amount of growth factor would be received by the cell would become hypersensitive. Or mutations in these proto-oncogenes that would activate them inappropriately, even when there's no signal around, would lead to cancer as well, would lead to oncogenesis. So that is the difference between oncogenes and tumor suppressor genes that we've considered. Tumor suppressor genes are, when mutated, are recessive to their normal genes, whereas proto-oncogenes, when mutated to oncogenes, are dominant to the normal copy. And this brings up a very important point about cancer, and that is that every cancer is, in a way, is a unique disease in the sense that there are different kinds of mutations that can lead to cancer. And different cancers have different degrees of malignancy. Some tumors are benign, and there is an overproliferation of cells, but it's not an aggressive tumor and can be removed easily and will not have metastasized, will not have sent cells to other organs in the body that would then lead to organ failure. But other cancers have numerous mutations in them, all of which lead to very aggressive tumors. And there are, basically, you can look at the tumor as an example, in a way, of natural selection operating at the cellular level. If you have a tumor composed of cells, many cells here, and this tumor is caused by a mutation in one or a few genes which lead to overproliferation, if you have another mutation, an additional mutation in one of those cells that lead to more proliferation, rapid proliferation relative to its brethren, then that will lead to a clone of tumor cells that is more aggressive and will take over the tumor. The tumor will get larger faster because it will be taken over by cells that have new mutations that are promoting uncontrolled growth. And for metastatic cancers, cancers which move from the organ of origin to migrate through the tissue to the bloodstream and then through the bloodstream to colonize other organs, that process is called metastasis. Metastasis involves further mutations, which can lead to very nasty cancers because if they colonize other tissues, then it's the cancer is much more difficult to treat. For example, a cancer that starts in pancreas and migrates to and metastasizes to lung, causes lung cancer, can be very, very, very dangerous. There are a high lethality rate for those cancers. Or ones that move to liver, for example, can be very, very fatal. So cancer is a complex disease. It involves mutation of tumor suppressor genes and proto-oncogenes, and both can occur in many cancers. We've talked about the high incidence of retinoblastoma proteins in cancers and P53. And you can have these mutations in addition to the other kinds of proto-oncogene mutations or oncogene mutations that we've talked about. So cancer is a very complex disease, and understanding the normal controls of the cell cycle and the signal transduction pathways that control the cell cycle can help us to understand cancer, and is therefore a worthy subject of study for all biologists. All right, now we're ready to tackle mitosis. So we'll be picking up next time with a detailed study of mitosis. And I knew that it was a fascinating subject, but had no idea that they were actually making major motion pictures that dealt with budding young biology students that are fascinated by mitosis. So here's a clip from a recent movie.
Prophase.
Do you mind if I look? It's Prophase.
Like I said. What?
Nothing. It's anaphase.
You mind if I check?
Sure.
Anaphase.
Like I said. It's metaphase. You want to check it?
I believe you.
So that's where we'll pick up with in the next segment of this lecture, the subject that has so fascinated these budding young biology students.